signature on the ratification of the Articles of Confederation.
So, the Union was part of the Confederation.
The Confederation was a part of the Union. The Confederation was the Articles of Confederation and Perpetual Union. The Union is perpetual. It never changed. Although we see a Constitution for the United States of America, the Articles itself. So, like, let me give you an example. All right. We have Morris Science Temple of America, right?
Mm-hmm.
So for Morris Science Temple of America, we have the Articles of Association, right? That's document number 101059/05. And then we have our Divine Constitution bylaws.
Bill of Rights.
Okay, we have our Divine Constitution and bylaws. So you have the Articles of Confederation that began back in 1778 and it was fully ratified in 1781. So now, after you had the sign, after you had the signers to sign on to be a part of this confederation, now you can go and create laws to institute how you're going to run the confederation. That's what the Constitution of the United States of America is. So you have the initial articles of the Confederation and Perpetual Union. And in these articles, it's like, we look at the back of the questionnaire and it says, let's see, pull it up here.
Man, this stuff is interesting.
All right, can you see my screen?
All right.
So this whole entire document consists of the Articles of Association, right?
Mm-hmm.
This right here is the Articles of Confederation, because this is what it is. It's a confederation.
Mm-hmm.
And the confederation is also a perpetual union, okay? Now, with the Articles of Confederation, and it says here, for what purposes the following persons were appointed chiefs according to the rules and usages of such Morris Science Temple of America, right? Now, the rules and usages is this right here.
Morris Science Temple of America, deriving its power and authority from the great Quran of Muhammad.
Right. This is the rules and usages, right? This is the same thing as the style of confederation shall be the United States of America. And then all of these articles within here, Article 2, Article 3, Article 4, 5, 6, 7, all the way down to, was it 13, 14 articles in here? I think it's 14, 13, one of them. That's what, it's the same thing as saying, deriving its power and authority from the great Quran of Muhammad to propagate the faith and extend the learning and truth of the great prophet of Ali in America, to anoint, appoint, and consecrate missionaries of the prophet, and to establish the faith of Muhammad in America. Right? It's the same exact thing. Nothing is different. We have to begin to look at these documents as what they truly are. These are commercial transactions that has taken place. Although we've been taught to look at it as if it is something outside of that. These are commercial contracts. Let's see. All right, and then what goes along with this is now, right, because this is how all of the, all these articles, this is how the board members will interact. These are the rules that the board members are following. Then we have the Constitution for the United States of America, right? Just like we have the Divine Constitution and bylaws of Moorshine's Temple of America. That's the one I want. I want to pull up the other one. All right. So with the Divine Constitution and bylaws, it is the same as saying, okay, this is now how all members within this Confederacy. So everyone who's now in union, not just the board members, but now everyone who's now within union, which is the United States of America, are now saying that we're going to be a part of the Constitution of the United States of America. It's the same thing with the Moorishine's Temple of America. So with the, let's see here.
This is interesting. How are they going to try to act like an Illinoisan ain't a state national when it says all the states can retain their sovereignty?
Well, see, the states gave up a majority of their sovereignty. Not when they came into the Union, but they gave it up when they became a franchisee of the District of Columbia. So we have the, let's see, with these organic acts.
Islam, Islam. This is Brother Sidney in Salisbury, North Carolina.
Go ahead, Brother Sidney.
So basically, with the screen that you have up now, You know, it says salvation, Allah, unity, more signs to engrave America, the divine constitution and bylaws. So when we look at the Articles of Confederation, 1778, just say from 1774 to 1881. The foundation.
The Articles of Confederation was from 1778.
Okay.
To 1781. Correct.
Okay. So basically, the same foundation, basically what you're saying, the same foundation that they built the Confederation on and ratified it in 1781 throughout the states with the Confederation being the United States is the same format that the Honorable Noble Drew Ali used or went and got to become a lawfully chartered organization.
That's correct.
Which thereby giving us a legal charter as Moorish America. And
as the Moorish Knights Temple of America and us being Moorish Americans. That's why what's his nationality, Moorish American? And then it says, what's your nationality, Moorish American? Yeah. Right? So, the 101s or the 102s, it acts something similar as the Pledge of Allegiance, right? The Pledge of Allegiance, it's like you say it and then you repeat it. You say it and then you repeat it, right? So someone is leading in the classroom, the Pledge of Allegiance, and then you're repeating back, right?
Right.
So it's also the same format of what they call the International Sunday School. Let me see.
But that would be on a religious charter, right?
Well, this it's our religion, brother.
So the Confederation was based on religion as well?
Correct.
Islam. That word religion, it's no different than deen.
Mm-hmm.
It's a contract. So the word religion goes back to bind. It's keeping you connected. No man lives unto himself, right?
Right.
So no matter what, when somebody's signing something, they doing some religious work.
Mm-hmm.
Period. It's like, I was able to figure it out on a harder level, but when Sis brought out the etymology of religion, that right there simplifies it. It doesn't even have to go that far. It's just, it's binding. So whatever is binding is religion.
That's right.
Islam, I think that's the simplest way to break it down for the Moors. And if you really want to look at it, I mean, look at the Bible and look what God commands the Israelites. And then look at America, or not America, look at the United States and look what they command their citizens.
Mm-hmm.
They control what they eat. They control the holidays. Everybody is practically off on Sunday. They switched up the holy day. It's very important to see the correlations between what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Islam, I just wanted to share that portion for the brother.
Islam, indeed.
This brother sitting there in North Carolina. So okay. When I look down in the 17th century,
mm-hmm.
at the amendments in the Constitution, What role did the amendment in the Constitution play in the foundation of the Confederation?
All right, so let me do it like this. Let's do it like this.
Thank you, Brother Sidney, because the way you're formulating your questions is also helping me piece together what she's trying to get us to understand. So I appreciate this.
Indeed, yeah. It really is.
Praise Allah. Right.
So, praise Allah. All right, so everybody can see my screen.
Islam.
All right. All right, so this is going, we're going to start our own society, okay? What's going to be the name of our society, y'all? Give me a name.
Man, Solid from the South. Nah.
Elgin Base.
Okay, L's. All right. L's and Base. All right. This is the name of our society. So we're going to say L's and Base Confederation. And perpetual union. That's going to be the name of our society. And we'll say, let's just take it from here. Shall be the L's and this again base let's do it like this of America.
Islam, Sister K.
Mm-hmm.
It was adopted. The Articles of Confederation was adopted.
Yeah, it was adopted by New Hampshire, Massachusetts Bay, Rhode Island, and Providence Plantations, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Delaware, Maryland, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia. That's who adopted it.
Now,
remember, hold on, pause. Remember, all of these are colonies with a charter from at that time, their charter they was using was the charter of Sir Walter Raleigh.
Whoa.
Charter of who?
I didn't think she was going to say something like that. I did not expect her to go there.
Well, this is the charters that they were using. They had the previous charter. Isabella and Ferdinand, right?
Ooh, well, what about Tamadin? Because I know Isabella, because those are Tamadin came in 1600. Isabella and Ferdinand, that was late 14, early 15.
So you had Isabella and Ferdinand who gave Columbus a charter, right? The charter was so vague, it really said that he could take over any island that was in the middle of the ocean. That's what the charter said.
No way.
Okay. Then you have the charter of you have the charter for these folks. What's the name?
I know the Puritans had got a charter around this early 1600s too. In South Carolina.
No.
Puritans. For a fact, I was researching it when I was doing some Sunday school study a few months ago, actually. They had got a charter too. They was one of the first known, even though I know it's not true in how they describe it, but first known religious charters.
Well, all of the charters were religious. I mean, even still to this day, the charters are religious charters.
Exactly. So I ain't gonna let them trick me, sis.
Yeah, they've always been religious charters. They never stopped being religious charters. I am looking for, let's see. There was a book that I've been doing some research from. Matter of fact, let me go here. Let's see. Redress.
So the charter with Isabella and Fernandez, that was late 1400, early 1500.
Right, so that one was just to go westward and find whatever land that you find where there's quote unquote savages, then you could set up pretty much a missionary post.
Okay, and the charter that Sir Walter who?
Sir Walter Raleigh. All right, here it is. Hudson Bay.
And who was Sir Walter Raleigh?
Sir Walter Raleigh was someone who went and did missions on the behalf of Queen Elizabeth.
You said he did missions on behalf of who?
Queen Elizabeth.
Okay. Sir Walter Raleigh.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Ooh, I'm gonna check his demonstration out. Walter.
Do you have a time frame?
Yeah, so the first one was charter to Sir Walter Raleigh. This is 1584. She granted him a royal charter.
Was that Roy Charlotte the only one that he had?
Yeah, that was the only one. Didn't have another one. All right. So we have tell us the first charter. See, this is what they were all coming over here for, looking to find gold.
Oh, so it's Raleigh, not Raleigh.
Yeah, like Raleigh, North Carolina.
Oh, you pronounced that Raleigh. Raleigh. That's okay. Oh, man.
Brother Sidney, we're not going to get on pronunciations, sir.
That's okay. I know how y'all New Yorkers are.
We're not even going to do that. But not ever. Let's see. Where is it at? Okay, yeah. In 1594, Raleigh heard of the city of gold in South America, and he sailed to find it. Publishing an exaggerated account of his experiences in a book that contributed to the legend of El Dorado. After Queen Elizabeth died in 1603, El Dorado, since Raleigh was again imprisoned in the Tower, this time for being informed of the main plot against King James I, who was not favorably disposed towards him. In 1616, he was released and led a second expedition in search of El Dorado. Isn't there a cartoon called In Search of El Dorado? You may not know
right where you're going. I know El Dorado was a ship at one time.
I do. And all the times you wasn't chosen, well, I'll make it up to you. All of the feelings you're not showing when you're it's the truth, swear to you, I do, I do, I do, I do.